Thank you, Anne. That was glorious. I have a few announcements before we begin our worship. If you are visiting us today, please fill out the blue visitor's card located in the pew in front of you and drop it in the offering plate later. Prayer request cards are also in the pews for any prayer request you may have. Please also indicate that if you wish to have your prayer request published on our weekly insert, please indicate whether you wish to have it published in our weekly insert and email. Pastor James, this Sunday, as you may have noticed, is on a staycation and will be doing a continuing education seminar next week, Sunday, May 1st. Final announcement, please save the date. Many of you will remember that last summer we had these very highly successful men's and women's conferences, and the date for that has been set, whereas further details will come out. That date, if you'd like to put it on your calendar, is Saturday, July 16th. And I hope we have as many people come out this year as we did last year, because it was an extremely successful, fun, and informative program. So may I ask you to rise as we read the call to worship? It is a responsive call to worship. Blessed is the one who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night.
He is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruits in its season, and its leaf does not wither.
In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the wicked will perish. I ask you now to join me in the hymn, number 343 in your hymnal, Amazing Grace.
Thank you.
You may be seated. Please join me in the prayer of confession, which is printed in your bulletin. We'll be saying it in unison. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have refused to hear the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. The Lord is compassionate and gracious, slow to anger, abounding in love. He will not always accuse, nor will he harbor his anger forever. He does not treat us as our sins deserve or repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his love for those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. I ask you now to stand and say hi to your neighbors. You can wave or whatever you like, whatever you're comfortable with. But I will note one thing. I'm gonna put something in your head before we get to the sermon. The anthem today is changed, and I'm not going to tell you the title. I'm going to ask you in the middle of the sermon, so you're going to have to listen carefully to see if you can catch the title of the piece that we're going to see, because actually it's important to the message. this time, I'd like to ask our deacons to collect the offertory. Dear Lord, we ask you to receive these gifts and offerings of our tithes, and we ask that you help and guide us to best use this in the service of your good work within this church. We ask this in Jesus Christ's name. Amen. Now, I'm going to already start off with another curveball. Those of you who are following the program will notice that there's supposed to be a scripture reading at this point. But actually, I'm putting the scripture reading in the middle. Because, in fact, to get there, I need to put a little bit of context into how this message fits in, not only with today, but also in the context of other messages that we've heard recently. So if I can have the next slide. You may remember Pat Hanley recently said that when he's been asked to teach a sermon, he has a lot more experience than me. This is only number three for me, okay? So take it easy. When you pray earnestly to the Lord, he will put a message on your heart. Now, in my case, somehow that message may come as a result of a little bit of procrastination, and rather than the still small voice that Elijah heard, after the wind and the Lord was not there, and after the fire and the Lord was not there, came the still small voice. And in my case, it's usually the swift kick in the pants. So in particular, the scripture that Pat was referring to, talking about the fact that the Lord will teach you and remind you what you need to know, is John 14:26. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything I have said to you. So, in fact, there are two events that led me to the phrase that I kind of fixated on that became the title of this particular sermon. And the first one was me getting dates mixed up. One of the things that Stephen ministers do is that at each meeting we assign who's going to be giving the devotional. Well, in honor of Spirit Fire, we shifted the calendar, but my phone didn't know that. And so I came in one evening where I had researched a devotional, and I said, this is it, and I'm ready to read it, and then it was Brenda's turn. So I just sort of held on to it, but in the meantime, having looked up a particular article, it really spoke to me in the phrasing, not so much of what was in the article, because I'm actually going to criticize it, that the author had a particular intended audience and took the message and narrowed it for the audience. And I want to try to broaden it back up and see if I can come a little close to what God intended that through Peter he was saying to us. And the title of that article was Caregiving is a Stewardship of Grace. So that is the title of today's sermon. It's Stewardship of Grace. And then, sure enough, I got a text from James saying, please give the sermon after Easter. And so I had a title. It was all good to go. But let's put this into context a little bit further, if we go to the next slide, because throughout February, James gave a series of three sermons on 2 Peter, 2 Peter 3. And this particular quote is from 1 Peter. Now, in fact, one way to paraphrase 2 Peter
why why why
Spiritual beings having a human experience. And I believe the latter. This humanity, this is temporary. That's the basis of our faith. And so we are spiritual beings. And that brings me to this last one in the middle. Now, I'm on session. I haven't been on there that long, a little bit more than a year. And so I don't know all the various things that will happen in a session meeting. We had one this past Thursday. And one of the things we did with typical Presbyterian formality and use of language was that we transferred the membership of Dottie Fowser to the Church Triumphant. And everyone was honored to be present and make that vote for our recognition that she is a spiritual being and that she continues on in the Church Triumphant. And so I don't feel so bad about adding an extra line to this. I think it's probably justified. So next slide, please. So finally, we'll get to the scripture reading. You got the introduction. That's 2 Peter, three sermons condensed into a few minutes. And now I want to read to you the region from 1 Peter that gives the phrase, gives some conditions, and then what is it we do about it? So 1 Peter 4, verses 1 through 5 are on this slide, and then they continue. Therefore, since Christ suffered in his body, arm yourselves also with the same attitude, because whosoever suffers in the body is done with sin. As a result, they do not live the rest of their earthly lives for evil human desires, but rather for the will of God. For you have spent enough time in the past doing what pagans choose to do, living in debauchery, lust, drunkenness, orgies, carousing, and detestable idolatry. They are surprised that you do not join them in their reckless, wild living, and they heap abuse upon you. But they will have to give account to him who is ready to judge the living and the dead. For this is the reason the gospel was preached, even to those who are now dead, so that they might be judged according to human standards in regard to the body, but live according to God in regard to the spirit. The end of all things is near. Therefore, be alert and of sober mind, so that you may pray. Above all, love each other deeply, because love covers a multitude of sins. Offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. This next passage is the focus for today. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace in its various forms. If anyone speaks, they should do so as one who speaks the very words of God. If anyone serves, they should do so with the strength that God provides, so that in all things God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. So this is the prescription from 1 Peter. And I pulled out a few highlighted words because they didn't use PowerPoint when they were writing down the Bible. And so it can be broken into a what and a how to do a particular action. And the what is, be alert and sober. Love each other deeply and offer hospitality. The how is speak with humility and reverence. We are not the source of grace. We are the recipients of grace. And we must never forget that merely as stewards of grace. Serve with God's provided strength. In all things, praise God through Jesus. And in the center of the what and the how is this phrase, stewards of God's grace. It's the one that I got kind of fixated on when I read that previous article that was supposed to be for Stephen Ministry, but is now this sermon. So good news, those of you checking your watches. I only got to define two words, steward and grace, and give a few examples, and then I'll stop talking. So what is this stewardship thing? Isn't that tithing? Well, in fact, I have stood in this very sanctuary and discussed 1 Peter, and stewardship at that point was taken in the context of tithing. But having read the full passage, is that a statement about money? I don't think so. I think it's a statement about something that is much broader. And so, in fact, Merriam-Webster had a very nice definition next to the word especially, that stewardship is the careful and responsible management of something entrusted to one's care. So if we are to be stewards of grace or have a stewardship of grace, what has been entrusted to our care is God's grace. And there is an opportunity that he can act through us as a manner of spreading this grace. Next slide. Who knows that? He knows that. That's Denethor, the steward of Gondor from the third of the three books from Tolkien, and also from the third of the three movies based upon Tolkien's Lord of the Ring books. There's a lot of Christian reference in those books. Now, I'm going to ask you guys a question. In this picture, where's the throne? Is the steward sitting in it? No. Where's the throne? The throne is that white chair at the top of the stairs, where it belongs. The reason there's a steward is that throne is temporarily empty. And at the bottom of the stairs is the steward, because that's where you put a steward. They're performing a service on behalf of the kingdom. They don't have ownership. They are not the king. But they nonetheless provide a service. Now, here's a question. If you walk into that room and you decide to pledge fealty, which is pledge yourself and your life to the service of, pick a chair, the white one or the black one. This was one of the scenes that is a shocking moment in the movie. Because one of our hero hobbits pledges their fealty to the steward. That is not what a steward does. The steward is on behalf of. The fealty goes to the throne. It goes to God. And also, by the way, this is a little bit of a spoiler. He's not a good steward. Okay, you'll find that out if you read the books or watch the movie. He's a bad example. Don't be like him for a steward. But I think that the principles here, and in particular this image, of the role of a steward are very clear. So the other word is grace. And in this case, it's taken from what I would have called my whole life the Encyclopedia Britannica. If you ask a kid these days what's an encyclopedia, they'll say, I don't know, but there are lots of pedias. There's Wikipedia and et cetera. And these are the modern substitute for encyclopedia. I think a bunch of us had this rack of books that either you got from your library at your school, or you may have even had some at home, et cetera, and those were your encyclopedia, and you looked things up. So this is Britannica.com, where they've dropped the word encyclopedia, but it's effectively Encyclopedia Britannica. And this is their definition of grace, which I found particularly good, and I underline one of the words myself. The spontaneous, unmerited gift of the divine favor in the salvation of sinners, and the divine influence operating in individuals for their regeneration and sanctification. Imagine that it were the worst. Think the reverse. Think about that word. Unmerited. We receive God's grace while not deserving it. What if you try to flip that around? Doesn't that sound like the modern definition of fairness? Maybe we should all check the boxes, and then God has no choice. God has no sovereignty. My boxes are checked. I'm in. Well, none of us would check all those boxes. And God would be reduced from an infinite source of love to a simple computer looking at checklists on a screen. This is one of the things about the Christian faith that makes it so unique and powerful. And that is that we receive the grace of the Lord at every one of those stages while we are still in spiritual death and all the way through every stage. So that's grace. Now here's, so the charge to us is this. What's stewardship of grace? We're neither the source nor owners of grace. We act in service according to the Lord's will, and we are oftentimes the mechanism by which God accomplishes his goals. And then I'm repeating the three what's and the three hows. What? Alert and sober, love each other deeply, offer hospitality. How? And they actually all say the same thing. Speak with humility and reverence. Serve with God's provided strength. In all things, praise God through Jesus. They all say the same thing. It's not about you. It's not about you. It's not about you. It's about God's grace. Now, here's a question. Have you guys ever seen something where you were filled with complete confidence that what I am observing is a stewardship of grace? I have. Next image, please. We saw that on Easter Sunday. That required people at 4 a.m. to come in here when it was already Easter, and take the symbol, the two crossed rough beams, the vilest device designed for death by torture in the history of man, and cover it with life. Now, I heard a lot of words that people used to describe this scene. It's pretty. Oh, it's so pretty. It's beautiful. Well, you know what? Every Easter is pretty and beautiful. I feel that this and our reaction, by the way, I put up Jeannie's picture, not because of the hat, but because of her taking a photo. The word that describes this to me is powerful. Because that image is our faith. It's the emergence of life after death. And that's what I consider as an example of stewardship of grace. Next image. You may have heard of this one also, Spirit Fire 22. And the picture on the bottom is the finale, the Saturday evening where people were gathered around the table, enjoying dinner together before we came up for a worship service. The worship service was open-ended. Started at 6, and said, when we're done, and everybody is comfortable and confident in having shared, we'll leave. And that was 2.5 hours. Who were the stewards here? You could point at a lot of different people. You could say, oh yeah, there's that evangelism committee, and they're promoting this kind of stuff. And you could say, well, come on. James and Pat, they were in the middle of this, and Liz, and et cetera, et cetera. I'm going to disagree. I'll tell you who I think were the stewards. Everyone. Because this group, given the opportunity, formed into little nests of about 10 people to have deep discussions of their understanding and their personal faith. And that is the moment that I believe was the stewardship of grace. And it was everyone. So, next slide. Now, there's a concern. Hopefully, next week we will not have 100 life-size crosses covered with branches on them, because everyone has been taught that's the one thing you do. And this principle, I don't believe, is limited to special occasions. It is not limited to Easter, to be within a stewardship of grace. It is not limited to an event that is held, even a month-long event at a church. Instead, stewardship of grace is an everyday phenomenon. And the cliche, yes, I admit this is a very cliche, is the grocery store clerk. That for whatever reason, humans naturally decide they're not going to treat so well. I don't know. There are lots of theories about why this is so. And so maybe it's because you're providing the service to me. Where does that place me? Maybe you're a disciple, and Jesus Christ is watching your feet. Maybe that's where it places you. But in any case, there is a cliche about not behaving well in this circumstance. And I want to tell you two things. First off, take every person who you've ever known, put them on a scale, good to bad, from your left shoulder to your right shoulder. Cool. Now, that they're all distributed between those two hands, put the Almighty in at one end. Where's everybody else? All the way over here, and we're all the same. But don't think of us as low. We have been found by the Almighty God to be deserving of love that is beyond our capability to even understand. And that grocery store clerk is the same. And if you understand that, just find out how you treat them. I think it turns out to be pretty good. So I know you can't read that bottom text. I will read it for you. I think it was something that I read a little more than a year ago. It was written by a fellow named James Cuby in 2019, and I think it does a fantastic summary of what we've been saying here today. What must we do? At least these four things. Build friendships with people who are very different from you, politically, socially, religiously, and invite them into your home, like the Bendas. This was a Czechoslovakian family that invited people who were different from them, different in culture, different in faith, into their home, one that is an icon of God's grace, peace, and welcome. Recognize that there is more information coming at us more quickly than we can possibly take in, and that the great temptation is to make snap judgments of events and about the content of our neighbor's character. Read adventure stories about boys and girls, men and women who set out against great gods and persist in a long, hard journey that teaches them to grow in wisdom, strength, and perseverance. Worship Sunday by Sunday. Come listen to a different story. The story of how the world is slowly, lovingly, graciously being put back together by God. Now, before we go to the final slide, I want to set it up and pose a question. Do you guys know the movie Evan Almighty? Okay. A guy named Evan, sort of an ordinary guy, a congressman, God came to him and told him during his first term in Congress, build an ark. Exactly like the original one. And he does. And so at some point, his wife, concerned about his sanity, is in the process of leaving and comes across God in the person of Morgan Freeman and has a short conversation. Now, what I want to pose to you is the following question. We have looked at 1 Peter after having looked at 2 Peter, and we have seen a call to be stewards of grace. And the question I want to ask, is this call an obligation or an opportunity? So please change the slide.
Oh, excuse me, can I get a refill, please?
Coming right up.
Thank you.
Excuse me, are you all right?
Yeah. No, it's a long story.
Well, I like stories. I'm considered a bit of a storyteller myself.
My husband, have you heard of New York's Noah?
The guy who's building the ark.
That's him.
I love that story. Noah in the ark. You know, a lot of people miss the point of that story. They think it's about God's wrath and anger. They love it when God gets angry.
What is the story about then, the ark?
Well, I think it's a love story about believing in each other. You know, the animals showed up in pairs. Mm-hmm. You know, they stood by each other, side by side, just like Noah and his family. Everybody entered the ark side by side.
But my husband says God told him to do it. What do you do with that?
Sounds like an opportunity. Let me ask you something. If someone prays for patience, you think God gives them patience? Or does he give them the opportunity to be patient? If they prayed for courage, does God give them courage, or does he give them opportunity to be courageous? If someone prayed for the family to be closer, do you think God zaps them with warm, fuzzy feelings? Or does he give them opportunities to love each other? Well, I gotta run. A lot of people to serve. Enjoy.
So if a church prays to move closer to God, does God give them the opportunity through stewardship of grace? In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen. Please rise if you are able for our final hymn, which is Living for Jesus, number 605 in your hymnal.
Thank you.
And now hear the benediction. Grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory, both now and to the day of eternity. Amen.